Welcome to Christ Church. Just a quick reminder that today is, since it's the first Sunday of the month, a 100% of the time mask day. Unless you are taking communion or up at the mic, please, we just ask that you keep your masks on. Thank you. Well, wanted to welcome everybody and just say how glad I am to be here this morning. It's been a couple of weeks since I've been here, and as we all know, things are crazy right now, so it's just good to be with you all this morning. As we prepare for worship, there are a couple of quotes. There's some scripture and then a quote on page 2 of your bulletin, just to kind of guide your thoughts as we go into this time of worship. So we'll have a little time of silence to prepare our hearts, and then I'll be back up here for the call to worship. Please stand with me for the call to worship. It comes from Psalm 63, verse 1 through 5 this morning. O God, you are our God. Earnestly we seek you.
Our souls thirst for you. Our flesh faints for you.
In a dry and weary land where there is no water, we have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and your glory.
Because you are still
we will bless you as long as we live, and in your name we will lift up our hands. We'll be satisfied as with fat and rich food, and our mouths will praise you with joyful lips. Please join me in prayer. Father, what this verse makes clear to me is that whether or not we want you, we need you. And our flesh does faint for you. Our souls do thirst for you, Lord God. And so we come to you this morning praying that you would meet us here as we are, Lord. Some of us coming maybe even perhaps unwillingly this morning to you. I pray that you would be with us, that you would show yourself enough to where we would earnestly seek you, that we would earnestly want you. And God, I pray that the truth of your word would bless our hearts this morning, and that we would worship you in truth. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Please join us in singing to the Lord this morning.
Come and worship.
we come to the time of confession, I wanted to read the verse here, Isaiah 30, 15, and then offer a brief explanation. Then I will read it again and ask you guys to read the prayer underneath it with me before we have our silent time of confession. But so it says, "For thus said the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in repentance and rest you shall be saved, in quietness and in trust shall be your strength." Westminster Confession of Faith says something like, "There's no sin too small, no sin so small that it could not lead to damnation, but there's no sin so big that the power of Christ cannot save you from damnation." And I think that that's an important perspective to have as we go into this time, as it offers for us two things. Obviously, we're sinful beyond our senses. We're sinful beyond what we can even perceive us as being, right? And so we pray that God would bring those sins into our vision so that we can be laid low and made humble before him and be free and honest in that as well. Because the second part of that is also true, which is that we are saved beyond the power of sin to damn us if we trust in Christ, right? So that truth then kind of brings this thing full circle, this confession of sin full circle into something that is hopeful beyond our wildest imagination, right? So that we can be free, we can be vulnerable before our God, our Maker, who is righteous and holy, and we are not, but we know that he has saved us through Christ. So I wanted to go with that this morning as we go into this, but I also just wanted to pause and take note of what God says to Isaiah here in this verse, which is that it's in repentance and rest that you shall be saved. So you have repentance and trust are kind of parallel there, and then rest and quietness, right? And so this idea of repentance in the Hebrew language is an idea of returning to God, returning to Christ, and then restful and being quiet in that. And so as we go into this today, I just want us to not think about this as a task that we have to do, you know, a confession of sin being a task, something that we need to do. Really, it's just a return to the King, a return to our Lord who loves us and cherishes us, and we can be quiet and we can rest in that. So I'm going to read the verse again, and then if you will read the prayer with me that is just below that verse, and then we will pause for a time of silent confession. "For thus said the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in repentance and rest you shall be saved. In quietness and in trust shall be your strength." Please read with me. "Gracious Father, you have surrounded us daily with your goodness and mercy. You have reconciled us by your sacrifice. You have received us as your own. You call us sons and daughters and love us with a persevering love. Nevertheless, we are insecure, fearful, and often faithless. We are rebels in need of rescue. We are doubters in need of your assurance. We are prideful in need of humility. Instead of depending upon your wisdom, we delight in our own strength and reply, 'O Lord, heal us.'" Amen. Please pause for a time of silent confession. Please stand for the assurance of the gospel. Here is a trustworthy statement that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to righteousness. To those who repent and look to Jesus Christ for their salvation, the forgiveness of sins is effected in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Maker of heaven and earth.
O Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths will declare your praise.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Please remain standing for the reading of God's word. The scripture reading this morning comes from Micah chapter 5, verse 1 through 5. Now muster your troops, O daughter of troops. Siege is laid against us. With a rod they strike the judge of Israel on the cheek. But you, O Bethlehem, Ephrathah, you are too little to be among the clans of Judah. From you shall come forth me, one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people of Israel, and he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. When the Assyrian comes into our land and treads in our palaces, then we will raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 princes of men. You may be seated. Please pray with me.
Father, we come to you this morning because you know us. God, you know us because you created us. Your word tells us that you knitted us together in our mother's womb. Lord, we know that you have framed the world just with your breath and with your word. God, and with all of that magnificence, we know that you're still mindful of us. And so we come to you. We come to you because you love us, and we know that you love us because you sent your son to live as a man, to prove to us your great love and your understanding of our humanity, Lord, and to save us from the sins that we've committed. God, we also need you. So we come to you like children in need. Despite your great love for us, we don't often reciprocate that love for you or for our neighbors. God, we are men and women of our own devices and schemes and plans. God, if we're haughty today, I pray that you would bring us low. And I pray that once we're low, Lord, that you would bring us to you. God, I'm afraid that for many of us, that prayer has been true in 2020. and it's difficult. And it's hard. Many of us are tired and destitute. We've been flooded with political propaganda. We don't know who to trust. We don't know what is true and what's not true and where to find information a lot of times. God, I pray that that truth would only strengthen our longing for the true King to return, a ruler that loves us beyond our understanding, a ruler that cares for his people more than himself. Lord, and I just pray that as we go about in this broken world, that what would be strengthened is our hope and our longing for you. God, many of us are sick and our bodies are broken with many ailments, including COVID-19. Life as we've known it for so long has been shaken and shifted immensely. I think we are low, Father, and I pray that you would raise us up with your love and your hope. I pray that you would help us to grieve the loss of our loved ones. Our fathers and our mothers, our grandmothers and grandfathers, our brothers and our sisters. And God, please forbid our children. We cry to you lacking understanding. Please strengthen our shaky faith. God, our arms are weary and our legs are shaking. May the hope of Christ's future return help us to endure and be always in our hearts and on our tongues. God, I pray that you would raise up your church as a vehicle for true religion during this pandemic. I pray that widows and orphans would find the warmth of your love in the body of Christ. I pray that we would begin to hear stories of Christ's church and Christ's body moving in ways that are unfathomable to the secular world, to comfort those who are hurting and to be with those who are sick or have lost loved ones. God, I pray that we would not only hear those stories, but we would also help to write some of those stories here at Christ Church. And so praying as you taught us, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Good morning. Excuse me. Let me pull this up a little bit.
Let me get a little higher up.
I'm Billy Crane. I'm the pastor here at Christ Church Kerrville. Thank you so much for joining us for worship today. I also want to say thank you to all of you who were praying for me and our family. We were in quarantine. One of my children was diagnosed with COVID, and we were all in quarantine for the Sunday before and after Christmas and the Christmas Eve service. And I just want to let you know we missed you. I can't think of a... it was a tough time to not be able to be with you, but I want to thank all of you who prayed for us and who sent us encouraging words and even gifts at times, and for all of you who kind of, all of you who came together to make the services happen and filled in where I needed help, thank you. It was such a testimony to me and an encouragement to me that I am not alone. Sometimes we need that. Sometimes we need to be in a little trouble so that we can see people rally around us and encourage us. So I want to say thank you for being the body of Christ and for being God's kindness and love to me and my family during the past, during our time of quarantine. It was a blessing to me. Thank you. A couple of announcements, not a lot, but the first is if you happen to be new here today, we just want to thank you for being here. We're so grateful you're here. And there's a place on the back where you can share your contact information if you'd like to receive information from our church. We will not pester you too much, just enough to get you to fun events and things like that. But if you'd like to fill that out, it's on the back page. You can just tear it off and set it in one of the baskets by the communion tables. Those baskets are for our tithes and offerings. And just a reminder if you have a gift that you want to give to the church, those baskets are there, and you can give that during the passing of the peace or during the time of communion. This Thursday, January 7th, we are having our ladies' night out. The ladies will be going to Yabo's right down here around the corner. Around the corner. They'll be meeting there at... what time do they meet there, Carrie? Is it 6 o'clock? 6 o'clock for a time of fellowship. If you have any questions, feel free to call Carrie or reach out to her. And our final announcement is that a month, basically 4 Sundays from today, on January 7th, we are going to be having a 2021 church information meeting, a 2021 Christ Church information meeting. And this is the first one we'll be doing of these in my tenures. It will be a congregational meeting after the worship service. It will be here February. What did I say? January. February. Sorry, I suffer from certain problems. And one of them is I can't get words right, you know. So February 7th, 2021, this will be our 2021 Christ Church Information Meeting. We're going to come up with a better name than that for this in the future, but at this meeting, we're going to be taking some time to reflect back on 2020, to look forward to 2021 and talk about some of the things that are our hopes and goals that as a church, and to present to you our 2021 budget. It will not be in super detail, but it'll be in, we will present the budget in the different categories and give you a chance to hear what is going on, to give thanks to the Lord for what He has done, and to ask His blessing upon us for what we as a church hope to see happen in 2021. So just want to let you know about that. That will be, like I said, on the first Sunday of February. That will be an all face covering Sunday. We did that intentionally, so those that that is a blessing and a benefit to them, they'll feel more comfortable being there. So we'll have our normal worship service and then a congregational meeting afterwards. So hope that you will join us for that. And now please join me as I invite you to the passing of the peace. The peace of Christ be with you. Please take a few minutes to greet one another, and we'll be back shortly.
How are you?
him get tested last night because he's got to get tested before he comes back to work. He wasn't San Antonio.
I
us and sing.
Well, we are in our last Advent sermon. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 2, looking at verses 1 through 12, if you'll go ahead and turn there. Next week, we're actually starting a series, a 12-week series on the book of Daniel, which I'm looking forward to, and I hope you are too. I guess this is the first you've heard of it, so I hope you'll start looking forward to it. It's a wonderful book, and but today, we get to finish up our Advent series. And at this point in the passage, it's important to note in Matthew 2, Jesus has been born, and there are men from the east who are seeking him out. These are the wise men, or the magi, as they're often referred to. And there is a king in Jerusalem who is not that excited to hear that a king has been born. So, that is our story today. We are going to be reading about the wise men coming to find Jesus following the star. And for many of you who've grown up in the church or have been involved in church for a long time, this is a very familiar story. And I want to ask you to do something today. I want to ask that as You hear this story, you try to listen to it as though you have never heard it before. I want you to ask yourself if there's anything in it that sounds strange to you, or catches you off guard, or even excites you, all right? Because this is not a children's story, even though it is. It's a story for all of us, and it has something very important to teach us. With that, please give your attention to the reading of God's Word, Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it was written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring word to me, or bring me word, that I too may come and worship him.' After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord lasts forever. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that your word has been given to us out of kindness and mercy, that you love us so much that you do not leave us in the dark, but you tell us the truth, that a king has been born who is worthy of worship. And we pray that today you will use these words to challenge, to encourage, to lead us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When I was in seminary, my roommate and I, and his name was Caleb, we were too cheap to pay for cable TV. We just didn't want to spend the money. But we had a problem, which was we both rooted for sports teams that weren't covered in our local area. So if we wanted to go watch a team play that we cared about, we typically had to go to a restaurant or go to a sports bar and watch it there. And my roommate, he loved to watch Louisiana Tech play. And the reason he loved to watch Louisiana Tech play was because his brother was the starting wide receiver for La Tech. And it was at the time when, I don't know, some of you might remember when Tim Rattay was the quarterback and he threw the ball all over the place. And so my friend's brother was having a great year. And for this particular game, he really wanted to see it because La Tech was playing Alabama. And Alabama that year, this was post-Bear Bryant, pre-Nick Saban, so they're kind of in the choppy waters of that time period for them, but they were supposed to have a good team. They had Sean Alexander at running back. He was a Heisman hopeful. They thought this might be the year that they win an SEC title, maybe even compete for a national championship. So my friend goes to this restaurant where they've got one TV dedicated to the Alabama-La Tech game, and he's watching it, and he realizes that he's surrounded by people who are Alabama fans. Like I said, this game wasn't on kind of the local TV, so unless you had cable, you had to go find some place to watch it. So he's watching this game with all the Alabama fans, and the plan was that Alabama was supposed to kill La Tech. They were supposed to destroy them. But it was a close game, and as they're watching the game, Caleb begins interacting with the other people. They begin kind of chit-chatting. They find out his brother plays for La Tech. They're having a great time. The game progresses, and the game's really tight. It's a close game. And it finally comes down to the last play of the game. There's 5 seconds left. La Tech has the ball on Alabama's 29-yard line, and they're down by 6 points, all right? The quarterback, Tim Rattay, who was a big-time player that year, got hurt on the previous play. So they send in the backup quarterback, Brian Stallworth. And you know how this is going to end, right? Like, there's no way they can win this. 5 seconds left, backup quarterback. Well, Brian Stallworth drops back and guns the ball into the end zone, which is caught by my friend's brother, whose name was Sean Cangelosi. And at that moment, my roommate is just overwhelmed with emotion. He is almost in tears, and he's trying to look for someone to hug and to high-five, and he's saying, "That's my brother! That's my brother!" But surrounding him are people that are cussing and throwing things and cursing La Tech and angry at the Alabama coaches and can't believe what has just happened. It's such an amazing response. The exact same thing happened, right? They both watch the exact same game, the exact same play, and yet one of them has the response of elation and joy, and the others have the response of anger and hatred and rage, right? Devastation. It's amazing how two people or two groups can have a different response to the same event. And that's what we see in this passage today. There is an event of greater note than a team upsetting the Alabama Crimson Tide in a football game. There is an event that has happened, that the King of the Universe has been born. And there are people who want to come and worship him. And then there's others who are threatened by him. And so the question I want to ask as we look at the responses of the people who are encountering Jesus in this passage is, how are we called to respond to Jesus? And we're going to look at this under three titles. First, the response of the wise men to Jesus, and we're going to spend most of our time here. Secondly, the response of Herod, the king, to Jesus. And finally, and briefly, we'll look at our response to Jesus, all right? So the first is the response of the wise men to Jesus. Little background, who are these wise men? The word for wise men in Greek is magi. And so that's why oftentimes you'll see the word, see it just written out as magi. And the term has actually got a long history in Daniel's day, who we're going to be studying next week. In Daniel's day, the magi were Daniel used the name of magi to refer to the wise men or the astrologers who interpret the dreams and the messages of the gods. By the time we get to the New Testament, it was used of anyone who used magical arts. Most likely, these magi were some form of astrologers / astronomers from the time, from the area of Babylon in Persia. And so they had the kind of the job of astronomers. They're the ones who study the laws and the movements of the stars, but they're also those that try to interpret the meaning of the stars, astrology, which the Bible does not commend, by the way. It's all for astronomy, not for astrology, but that's what these men are doing. And somehow, by looking at the stars and probably having some information we don't know about, and obviously having God leading them, these men have deduced that there is a king of the Jews who has been born, whom they need to seek out and they need to worship. And it's led them to Jerusalem to get more information about who this king is and where he is. And something to remember is that although when we think about the wise men, we think of them fondly. We think of people seeking him out. And the people of their own hometown would have held them in high regard because these were wise men. You know, they could understand messages from the gods and study the stars. But to the people they were going to when they showed up in Israel and Jerusalem, they would have been held in contempt and disdain. These are pagans, idol worshipers, all right? They're kind of what you would think of as kind of a cross between some crazy mystics and a New Age cult. These are not the people you want your children hanging around with, all right? If you sent your son or daughter off to college and 2 weeks later they called you and said, "Hey, my roommate is just really into like horoscopes and astrology," you'd go, "Oh my goodness, we should have paid for a single room after all." I mean, that's what you'd have said. You don't want to be hanging around with these guys. And yet, here they are. They've shown up in Jerusalem looking for Jesus. And That's the plan. They've been searching. They find their way to Jerusalem. And in verse 2, we see the only words they say in this whole passage. In verse 2, it says, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." And Herod and the people in the courts of Jerusalem don't know what this guy is talking about. So Herod calls the scribes and the teachers of the law, and they begin to tell him that the Messiah who was to be born was to be born in the town of Bethlehem. And I want to just take a step back and look at this interesting picture that the Lord paints for us here. This interaction, this picture of God's general revelation and his special revelation. Where God uses general revelation to get these people to Jesus, but it's not enough. All right. And when I talk about general revelation, what I mean is what we can discern about God from the world around us. The Bible makes it clear that people know that there is a God. They know that because the image of God is on them, that God's law has been written on people's hearts, even though they reject it. But also nature and history tell us that there is a God. And these men use nature. Now, this is a kind of a symbolic picture that nature is leading them. Nature is leading them to Jesus, right? This star has brought them to wanting to find this king, and yet it's not enough. It won't get them all the way. They come to Jerusalem saying, you know, we've got this star that's telling us that the king's been born. Where's the king? And where do they have to go to find out exactly where the king is? They have to go to Scripture. They have to go to God's special revelation. They have to go to a place where God clearly reveals himself. And God gives them this word from the book of Micah, where he tells them that the king will be born in Bethlehem. And one commentator spoke about this and said, "Creation's revelation can bring human beings only halfway. Scriptural revelation has the power to bring us home to Christ. God in his goodness is the author of both revelations and uses them both." And so we see God drawing these men to him using both general and special revelation. And ultimately, let's not miss the fact that it's God who's doing this. God is the one who draws these men. He is the Lord of history. He is the Lord of the stars. And it even says in that quote from Micah that this king will be a shepherd of his people, right? And what a beautiful picture of God shepherding these men to the king. He's kind of corralling them this way and that, and eventually gets them to Bethlehem. And so these men hear the truth of where the Messiah is, and they decide to go and find Jesus. Bethlehem was only about 5 miles north of Jerusalem, and they go to find him. And as they approach Bethlehem, just remember that this isn't the night of Jesus' birth. All right, that's the way we do the manger scenes, is that the wise men are there, but they're not. They're far away. They haven't gotten there yet. And by this point, it's months, maybe even a year or so later. Jesus and Joseph and Mary, it says, are living in a house. That's what it says in verse 11. But as they get closer and see the star directly over this house, it says that the Magi are filled with joy, verse 10, that they go in verse 11 and worship him. They worship Jesus. They give to him something that is due only to God, right? And then it says in verse 11 that they present him with gifts, gold, frankincense, myrrh. What a beautiful response to Jesus. Joy, worship, the giving of our gifts. That's how we are called to respond to him when we encounter Christ in our life. When we encounter him for the first time and we encounter him every day. And from this passage, from what we see of the Magi, there's a couple truths that I want to point out. And one point that is made clear in this and made clear throughout the whole book of Matthew is that Jesus is for the whole world. All right? It's not a coincidence that Matthew begins a book with the first people worship. Well, in Matthew, the first people worshiping Jesus are non-Jews. They're people from outside of Israel. And then the book ends with Jesus giving this commission, the Great Commission, to his disciples, saying, "Go and take the gospel to all nations so that all people might worship me." And just remember, Matthew is a book written primarily to a Jewish audience. So he's making it clear, yes, the Messiah is for you, Israel, but the Messiah is for the whole world. Jesus is in the process. The nations are being drawn to worship Jesus. And so when John says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish but have eternal life," it is for all people that that promise is made. And the point is that all men and women will ultimately bow their knee to him in worship. Now, I think there's some really beautiful applications here. And one of them is that we are called to cultivate a heart for both evangelism and world missions. It's easy for us, particularly us in the church, to feel like God is for us, which he is, and to just leave it at that. And to not realize that God has a heart for the world and he calls us to have a heart for the world as well. Everything outside of our own little world, if you will. And so I think one of the applications of this is that we as individuals and that we as a church would be people who have a heart for missions, both local, regional, national, and world missions. That we would be those who pray for those, pray that that those who don't know Christ would come to know him. We would pray for those who have a heart to go and take the good news to people, take the good news of Jesus Christ to people. That we would be those that would encourage those in that work and even give to them financially. You know, I just want to let you know that one of the reasons that I have people involved in other ministries come and preach on a pretty regular basis is so that you and I will get to hear about what God is doing in other places. And although I know that you can't necessarily financially support all of those people, my goal is that maybe one of them you will own, adopt, if you will, and they'll become someone that you pray for, that you encourage, and if possible, even financially support. Now, maybe you've got people like that already in your life, and I cheer you on in that. But if you're looking for someone to pray for, encourage, and support in missions, please know that that's one of the reasons that we as a church bring people in those other ministries in. We as a church, as I said, will be presenting our budget on February 7th, so you can see it. And if you want to see it sooner, you can come and make a meeting with me, and we'll talk about it. But one of the things we increased was our missions budget, our giving to both local, state, regional, and world missions. And ultimately, our church has a goal that at some point, and we're striving for this, is that 10%, like a tithe, 10% of our budget at a minimum will be committed to missions. Why? Why are we doing that? So we can pat ourselves on the back and tell everybody how holy we are? No. The reason we're doing it is because God cares about the world. God cares, and God wants the world to come and know him, to worship him. And we see this in the Magi, that those from outside were being brought in. And therefore, we as a church have a heart for missions. And not only that, because remember, the people of Israel would have initially looked down upon these Magi, these wise men. Come on, pagan worshipers? No. They would have looked down on them. And there's really not just a heart that we would want to see people from around the world to come to know Christ, but we would have a heart for them, that we would long for them to know Jesus, that we would have a heart for people who are not like us. As I said, the Magi would have brought forth contempt and disdain into the hearts of many of the Jews. Who are the people that you don't really like to be around? Who are the people that you have contempt and disdain for? The Lord calls us to soften our hearts and have a heart for those who look differently from us, think differently from us, vote differently from us, smell differently from us. The sad thing is that because we're sinners, we see other people that are different from us, and a lot of times we just go, no thanks. I don't want to be around you. I admit with shame, I was remembering this week a conversation, an interaction I was having with a person from a different background from me, who had a different past from me, that was from a different place than me. And I found myself just wanting to kind of get away from them. And the reason was because I was looking down on them because of things that they had done. I was looking down on them because of where they were from. And when I stopped and reflected on it, I said, oh, you know what that is? That is prejudice and contempt in my heart that looks down on them because they're different and they're not like me. And I'm not willing to show them grace or forgiveness or kindness. I'd rather just be away from them. And what Jesus is, what Matthew is telling us and what the Lord is telling us in this passage is that we are called to not just have a heart for people different from us in theory, but in reality. That we are called to love those that are different and make space for them and get to know them and care for them. And ultimately, show them the love of Christ, either through our words or our actions. That's one of the things the Magi are teaching us here, or we're learning from this about the Magi. The last thing I want to point out from the Magi is that I think there's a beautiful application to take people to the Bible. Take them to Scripture. You know, in the world that we live in, people know that something is not right. You know, they know that there's a God whether or not they'll admit it or not. But they know when they look around the world that things are not as they should be. And they're looking for answers. You know, when I think about this sometimes, and this is a silly example, but me and my two younger kids love to read Encyclopedia Brown books. And in those, they kind of tell the story and all the facts are laid out, but nobody can make any sense of them. Somebody's guilty of something, but the one person who can solve it is Encyclopedia Brown. Encyclopedia goes, I've got the answer. And that's what the Bible is. People have all these facts laid before them, and they know that something's not right, and they don't know what to do. And the answers are found in the Scriptures. And we are called to take people to them. Let them find the clarity they need from the truth of God's Word. And I know a big obstacle that's been in my life on this, and I'm sure for some of you, is like, well, why should I tell people about the Bible? Because if they don't believe it. Like, there's people like, I don't believe the Bible. So what would be the good of telling them about it? You know what? It doesn't matter if they think it's true or not. It's true. All right? It's like someone, I'm sure there's someone in this world who thinks that the Grand Canyon doesn't exist. You know the best remedy to that? Take them to the Grand Canyon. Let them look at it. Let them look over the edge. They will soon realize it is true. And ultimately, it's God who's the one who will soften their heart on this. So what I'm encouraging you to do, like the wise men who needed greater clarity and direction, if you've got someone that's asking questions and struggling, whether they are dismissing the Scriptures or not, open it. Open it. Open God's Word. It is living and active and sharper than any double-edged sword, right? And ultimately, it's the Spirit who will wield that thing, not you. Share the good news and let it do its work. So those are just some applications I wanted to take from the story of the Magi, that we have to have a heart for world missions, that we need to have a heart for those that are different from us, and to take people to the Scriptures. Those are ways that we can respond to Jesus from the example, from the applications we see in this text. The second person I want us to interact with is Herod. How does Herod respond to Jesus? Now, Herod, who was called Herod the Great, is a fascinating historical subject who happens to be a terribly horrible person. He had a diverse background. He was racially an Arab, a descendant of the Edomites. He was religiously a Jew, though you wouldn't probably call him a faithful Jew. He was culturally Greek. He was into Hellenization. He wanted things to look like the Greek world. But he was politically Roman. He was allied with them. In fact, the way he got the job was he was friends with Mark Antony and Octavian, and Octavian would go on to be the first emperor, Caesar Augustus. And they recommended that Herod be made king over Israel. And so the Roman Senate in 40 BC made Herod king over Israel. And he went in and there was kind of an anti-Roman king that was set up, and he got rid of that guy. And by 37 BC, he had gotten control of Israel, and he ruled it from 37 BC to 4 BC. And when the Senate made him king, they gave him the title, and catch this, they gave Herod the title, the King of the Jews. All right? Herod, King of the Jews. And something else you should know about Herod was that he was an excessively cruel human being. He was threatened very easily and insecure. And if he thought somebody was a threat to him, he would eliminate them. He had his favorite wife killed. He had two of his children killed, multiple family members. In fact, Caesar Augustus, who was a personal friend of Herod's, had said, I would rather be Herod's pig than one of his sons. And the reason he said that was because as a Jew, Herod wouldn't kill or eat a pig, but he wasn't afraid to kill one of his own children. And so this is the person that the Magi show up to and say, hey, we have come seeking the King of the Jews who has been born. We have seen his star in the east. And the response from Herod in verse 3 is that he is troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. Because he's thinking, you're looking for the King of the Jews? I'm the King of the Jews. You're saying there's another king? You're saying there's a rival out there? I'm going to have to do something about that. And so all Jerusalem is troubled too, because they know what happens if Herod is troubled. It means people are going to die, and maybe some of them. And so Herod, he too hears God's word. He calls for the scribes and the teachers of the law, and they come and tell him what is to happen, that there is that the Messiah is to be born in Jerusalem. I'm sorry, in Bethlehem. And he calls the Magi to himself and says, you guys go and find this king. And if you find him, let me know so I can come and worship him. And we know that those were, that he had actually bad intentions. But what Herod ultimately does, or initially does, is nothing. His response to Jesus, his response to God's word, is indifference, and he ignores him. The wise men travel the 5 miles to go find Jesus, to go worship him, to give him their gifts. Herod just stays at home. He's happy in his own little world. He doesn't want anything to do with Jesus. It's not until he realizes that the Magi had found something that he gets angry. And we find out later that he doesn't just want to ignore God's word, he wants to usurp it, overthrow it. God had promised that a king would be born in Bethlehem, and what we find out in the next section is Herod's response to this is anger, and he seeks to kill this king. He seeks to kill Jesus and slaughters children in order to bring an end to a rival king. What can we learn from this about Herod as we look at this other response to Jesus? Now, one of the things that startled me as I read this is that someone can have access to all the benefits and the things of God and be completely lost. Here's this man. He lives in Jerusalem where the temple is. He has access to God's word and the teachers of God's law. He's been raised at some level in the Jewish faith, and yet he completely has no concern for the king, for the true king. In fact, he wants to have him destroyed and killed. And there's a warning to us here. Don't be fooled. Just because you and I have lived our entire lives surrounded by the things of God, we can still be lost. I was at a nursing home at one point talking with an older gentleman who I'd known, and I was friends with him, and we talked regularly, and yet I could see from this person's life that they did not care much for the things of God. They had grown up in the church. I know they'd been a member at some point, but God just didn't seem to be very important to him. And as I talked with him, I began sharing the gospel with him and asking him about Jesus, and all of a sudden he stopped me and he said, whoa, I believe all that stuff. I believe all that stuff about Jesus. It's just not that important to me. And that was a very startling thing for me to hear. I know all these facts. I just don't care. We can know a lot about Jesus and yet not know him. And therefore, we see this in the life of Herod. There's a warning. Don't think just because you and I go to church, or we were baptized, or we were raised by Christian parents, and are a member someplace, that just means that we know the Lord, that all is good. My encouragement and challenge to you is to examine your heart and to say, is Jesus worthy of your worship? Or do you worship him? Does he fill you with joy? Do you desire to give him your treasure? Because that's the response that we are called to have. As sinners, we fail. I know this. But is he in your life? Is he in your world? Or is he just something on periphery that you touch maybe at Christmas or Easter or just when somebody makes you? The Lord is to be the most important thing in our life. A second warning that I see in this passage is that when we seek to ignore or usurp God's word, people get hurt. In this situation, when Herod does it, children die. When we do it, maybe it's not murder, but when we ignore the command to love our neighbor as ourself, or ignore the command to be generous with our time and money or talents, we end up running people over with our selfishness and our self-preservation. You know, and we're a lot like Herod. We leave destruction in our wake. There's broken relationships, wounded people, people that whether have been stolen, we have stolen from. We've stolen their time. We've stolen their possessions. We've stolen their dignity. That is a dangerous thing. It is dangerous. Don't think that there are not consequences for ignoring God's word. If he says it will happen, it will happen. If he says that this is the result of doing this or not doing this, you can be confident that it will happen. I think oftentimes we hold ourselves up like Herod as the judge of God's word, and God says, you know, do this and this will happen. And we go, I'll see for myself. And in the process, we end up hurting others, and we end up causing damage to ourselves as well. So there's a warning there. There's a warning to not ignore God's word, not usurp God's word, because it has damaging effects on us, and other people get hurt as well. And the last, and I just want to close with this, as we reflect on this passage, is what is our response to Jesus? As we look at the Magi and we look at Herod, I think it calls us to examine our own hearts, because we're like them. Did you know that? We're like the Magi. We are those who were far off that God has drawn to himself and brought near. We're like Herod as those who want to be their own king. We want to be the center of our own life, establish our own kingdom, and not have anybody tell us what to do. And the question that this passage asks us as we respond to Jesus is, what is our heart towards him? Are we indifferent? Are we threatened by his presence in our life? Are we angry that he is here and trying to tell us what to do? Please, and let me encourage you to look at Jesus, to seek him out, and to give him your life and your worship and your gifts. Ask yourself the question, who is the king of my life? Who is it that I seek to give my worship to? Where do I lay my treasure? Where do I give it? If Jesus isn't in that picture, we're in a dangerous place. My encouragement to you is look again to Jesus and ask yourself, is he the king of my life? Is he the one who I would want to worship? I just want to close with this quote. The picture of the Magi serves as an encouragement. What can happen to us by God's grace? The picture of Herod is a warning. What can happen to us when we despise God's grace? Let us run to Jesus. Let us receive his grace with joy, and let us give him the worship that is due him, because he is the great king. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us, and that you love us so much that you would send your only son to live and die for us. Father, we pray that we would not respond to the great king with indifference. We pray that we would not seek to overthrow him as king in our lives and in the world around us. We pray that you would give us hearts to receive him, to worship him, and to experience the joy that comes with laying our gifts before him. We pray for this, Lord, and we pray for our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We now come to the Lord's Supper. And this is a meal for sinners, a meal for those who see their desperate need for Jesus because they stand before God condemned. If that is you, if you realize that you need God's grace because you can't stand before him on your own, this meal is for you. Because by partaking of this meal, you're saying, Jesus is my king. Jesus is my only hope. Jesus is my savior. If that's not where you are today, if you don't know Jesus Christ, if you've never put your faith and trust him, and if you're a person who knows a lot about Jesus, but you don't really care much about him, I'm grateful that you're here. I'm grateful that you're hearing about who this Savior is. And I just want to let you know that this is a good place for you to be, a good place for you to ask questions and to learn more about Christ. But we ask that before you come to this meal, you come to Christ first. Because by partaking of this meal, you are declaring that he is your Savior and Lord. And I want to let you know that because we have a gracious God, who wants all to come to know him, those who are near and those who are far away. No matter who you are or what you have done, no matter what people think about you, no matter what disdain or contempt man has shown you, the God of the universe welcomes you in and longs to call you his child. If that resonates with your heart, even today, you can do that. You can do that right now. In fact, on the back page of our bulletin is a prayer of belief, and I would encourage you to cry out to him and even use this prayer as a way to say, I need you, Jesus. When we look at this meal, when we look at the bread and the wine, it is food. And if you're like me, one of the things about food that I recognize is that I need it. I need food. If I do not eat, I will die, right? That is our response to our Savior. This bread, which represents his body, this blood, which this wine, which represents his blood, what they are saying to us is just like you need food and drink, you need this Savior. He is what sustains you. If you go without him, you might last a while, but ultimately, you will perish. He is the only one that can sustain you now and for eternity. Please join with me in responding to these words on page 9. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy Father, creator of heaven and earth, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give thanks and praise to your glorious name. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Amen. If this side of the congregation will use the table over here, and we can start from the back to the front, and if this side over here will use that table to get communion, and we'll go from actually front to back over here. And please come forward as you feel led. The body of Christ, broken for you. Take and eat. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Take and drink. Please stand and join with me in this prayer of thanksgiving. Most gracious God, we praise you for what you have given and for what you have promised us here. You have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth.
You have fed us with the bread of life and renewed us for your service. Now we give ourselves to you, and we ask that our daily living may be part of your kingdom, and that our love may be your love, reaching out into the life of the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please join us in singing for one more time.
Thank you so much for joining with us today. If you're able to help us afterwards, we have to break down in here. So if you're able, please help us. If not, I completely understand. Did I do something wrong? Oh, and the poinsettias. Where are they? There's 10. And if you, are they, you're welcome to take them. There will be no fights over them. So be gracious with one another. But there are 10 poinsettias around, and we would love for you to have one. First come, first serve, just no fighting, okay? Please receive this blessing from the book of Numbers, God's benediction upon you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.
William, will you help with the chairs, please? Thank you. What was that? Would you help with the chairs, please? I don't know if they brought all the stuff out, but would you help?
I'm okay.